You're listening to Right On by Final Draft. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft, and this is the screenwriting podcast where we talk to educational organizations about hiring SAG-AFTRA actors. Today's guest is Darrien Michelle Gipson. She is the executive director of SAGindie. She has a background all over production. She was formerly the vice president of production at Def Pictures. She also has an MFA from USC, if you weren't impressed. She's been with SAGindie a long time. SAGindie itself was formed in 1997, and it connects professional actors with independent filmmakers. You can probably understand why we wanted to talk to Darrien on the podcast, just to get this information out to all of us out here listening and trying to make our own stuff. So welcome, Darrien Michelle Gipson.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Darrien, I'd like to start up just how you got into show business in general.
In general? Ooh. It's a weird story, and I actually just knew. I'm one of those kids who grew up not knowing that I wanted to be a director or anything like that, but I just always wanted to be affiliated with movies. So when I was 12, I think my mom brought me to Los Angeles because I'm from Northern California, and we were going to a friend's wedding, but she had the cab driver drive through UCLA. That was all it took. I finally just said, oh, okay, so I want to work in film. I want to go to UCLA. From that moment on, I either never varied my thoughts or I never matured beyond that. I'm not sure which.
That's fantastic. So how did you get involved in SAGindie? Let's go there right away. It's an unusual place to end up. I mean, obviously, there's not a lot of these options, but you got there.
It's a really interesting place to be. And I think I'm really lucky that I was working as a vice president of development for a production company for Def Pictures. And I enjoyed it. But at the time, Def Pictures had just lost their deal and the company was disbanding. And I was trying to decide what I wanted to do next. And my thought was, okay, I should go get another development job. But honestly, at that time, I wasn't really enjoying it. I loved developing, but I didn't like all the stuff that went with it. And there's a lot of kind of negative. I got tired of finding reasons to tell people no. And somewhere in the back of my mind, I said, I want to be somebody who tells people yes. I want to be somebody who is helping them further instead of always being the gatekeeper to keep people from making things. And so it just so happened one day I saw a really weird, cryptic advertisement for a job that made no sense. And once I clicked on it, it said, do you like independent film? Do you like nonprofit? And do you like to travel? And I just was like, yeah. 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 So I applied for this crazy job on the 48 hours that the job was listed. And the legend has it, he had 400 resumes. And I just managed to outlast, outwit, and outplay everybody else to get the job. And so I came in as the traveler, the person who would go every week or so to a festival, talk to filmmakers, do whatever. And then a few years in, the person who hired me decided he wanted to go do something else, and he sold me the corporation. That's how I came to be.
Wow, and there you are. I mean, you're on top of it now.
I've managed not to sink it. Every day I'm grateful for that.
So let's talk about what SAGindie does. I mean, we can start as basic as you like for all the listeners who have never heard of this and are probably intimidated by this entire topic.
Our mandate and our mission is pretty simple. Our job is to help independent filmmakers understand the proper way to hire professional actors. Along the way, we explain to them contracts that they're going to use, how much money things will really cost them, how to get through the process so that if they're going to hire a professional SAG-AFTRA actor, they'll know the right process to do it. And we kind of demystify that process. We try to answer any questions, and we just kind of hold hands. However, we do not work for SAG-AFTRA. So our job is really just to tell people what the lay of the land is. If you want this person, this is what it'll cost you. This is the contract. This is what it means to distribution. If you don't, then cool. Do what you're going to do. And if you have any other questions, we're happy to talk about that. But primarily, it's about contracts and understanding what it means when you engage in a process that involves SAG-AFTRA so that you know what you're doing before you start that process.
Wow. So before you start that process, I mean, how do you even begin to educate yourself?
I understand how daunting it is. And for everybody on my staff, and we are tiny but mighty, we only have 4 people in Los Angeles and 1 in New York, but we all have film degrees. And we've all made films in different ways, shapes, and forms. So our job is to interpret contracts in ways that filmmakers can understand it. So because we understand what they're trying to do, we can kind of explain to them what that contract means in the context of filmmaking. It ends up looking like a lot of different things, but really we just hold hands with people who were scared and say, not a problem. We know what you're trying to do and we can help you get there. And if ultimately you choose not to hire a professional actor, or you're not going to go with SAG-AFTRA, that's fine with us. We figure if you don't do it with this one, you'll probably want to do it for another one. We're still happy to help you any way we can.
First off, I mean, if you're going to hold my hand, how much does this cost as I learn this stuff? And how much do I have to pay to get this advice?
Pete, I will hold your hand for free. In fact, our service is completely free to anybody who wants to call us, email us, whatever. We are a completely free service.
So it's a fantastic place to get started. The website's great. It has a lot of great frequently asked questions. I might even ping on a few of those later. Why does SAG-AFTRA need independent filmmakers to hire? I mean, there's no budget. There's not a lot of money. Why even make that connection?
A couple of reasons, really. Number one is that actors want to act. They're funny that way. They, you know, at their core, they really do want to work. And they can't if nobody's hiring them. And independent film, of course, is where so much really incredible, good filmmaking is happening. And that's their chance to break in and build their resumes and to star if possible. So this is a fertile ground for actors. But for a long time, and when this organization was created, people were too afraid to approach SAG at the time, now SAG-AFTRA. They didn't want to call them. They didn't want to ask questions. They were afraid of making mistakes. And so their answer was just to either not hire those actors at all or to convince people like, we'll just do it under the table. Nobody will notice, which people generally do notice at some point. If you're at all good at it, people will notice. That's the whole point of being good.
Right.
And so we were created to kind of say, okay, don't panic. If you want to use this person, it's not that hard. It's not that bad. You don't have to worry. We'll show you how to do it. We'll tell you about all the paperwork. And you can just do it the right way. Because ultimately, filmmakers want to be filmmakers. They want to have a career doing this. And you can't do that if you're always afraid of your own shadow. You have to just learn how to do it properly.
Let's go through, if you don't mind, sort of a mock process here for a minute. I mean, does this apply if my friends and I just want to make a quick web series? And I mean, I got a friend who's in SAG and he wants to work with us. We don't have any money, but does that matter? Is that the point where I should start thinking about getting involved, becoming a signatory?
The truth of the matter is if you have a person who is in SAG-AFTRA who wants to do anything with you, you have to have them under a contract. Even if that contract is for the most basic $12 production, because the contract is more than money or anything like that. It really is, one, to say that you realize that this is a person who has backing. So you have to treat them well. And that doesn't mean lavish. It means respectfully. You cannot work them 18 hours and then put them in a car and make them drive themselves home. You cannot make them go all day without food or a place to sit down. At its core, all of these rules come down to the basic idea of taking care of the people who are working for you. It's pretty simple. And from that point, it comes, as your budgets get bigger, it gets more specific. But at its core, it's about showing people respect. And then it's also got a financial part. But at a low, low budget, that part is not very high.
So there is something, but as long as I can get started, I mean, as long as I have something to start with, some money, then I might be able to take advantage of my friends and who I want to be in something like this.
Honestly, your budget is... it's secondary to what you're doing, although it does dictate how much you'll pay. But there are plenty of people who are making things for next to nothing. So it's not like, well, you have to have $50,000 if you want to hire. No, there are people who get everything donated. Their dad has a camera. They have a great house, whatever. And that's perfectly fine. So you can do it for very little money. You just have to still sign off with SAG-AFTRA that you will take care of their person. And then you can learn, like, oh, if this goes to distribution, then I'll owe them some money, or whether or not I need to pay them something up front.
Right. So that's not necessarily automatically a bar to entry.
No, not a bit.
If I was going to do something like this, it's just a couple friends, do I need to become a SAG signatory?
No, and I would highly recommend that you don't. Because what happens is you as the creator, if you do it under, let's say, Pete's company.
Sure.
And you sign a signatory agreement, then Pete's company is forever signatory. And you cannot make anything that is non-signatory to the union. So instead, when you're doing low budgets, that's why you LLC your project, or you create a corporation around your project. If your movie is about shoes, then it'll be Shoes LLC, and that becomes signatory. And when that's signatory, then no matter what happens, it only deals with that entity. So if everything goes awry and, God forbid, it all blows up, they can't go after you. They being everybody involved, it goes against that production. And that's why you have to be careful who signs and what they're signing under.
Right. So it's basically making a little island out of an LLC to protect everybody and to sort of keep one project, one movie, presumably under that umbrella by itself, right?
Exactly. It is literally to limit your liability.
That's perfect. And that entity can be the signatory. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So that's how we constantly say, please don't do it. If you have a company that is going to want flexibility in what you do, then you don't want to make that company signatory, because that's going to define how you can do certain things. So create your island of your project, and it keeps it over there in an entity unto itself.
That's a great place to start, because that's a mistake I think many of us would not have understood. What about my own production company? What makes that official? If I make an LLC, is that what I need to get that signatory, or do I just need a shingle and a name?
Ultimately, they're not as worried about your company. Your company is really for you. It's not so much for SAG-AFTRA. They want to know what the project is and who is the person who's going to be responsible. So if you don't get your LLC and you just do it Pete's company, they're more than happy to let Pete's company do that. It's not their problem. That's more your problem.
Right.
So you just have to make that decision and be smart about it to protect yourself. And a lot of times people think, oh, because SAG-AFTRA could do this, that, and the other. It's really not about SAG-AFTRA as much as it's about protecting yourself from any possibilities and any problems. If a person gets hurt on your set, be they an actor or a grip or anything, you are liable. And so you have to do certain things to protect yourself as any employer would. And when you're a filmmaker, you are an employer. By the rights of the Department of Labor in this nation, they consider you to be an employer. That's why you have to have workers' compensation insurance. Because if you don't, and somebody who is going to your set, even if they're not there yet, if they have an accident and hurt themselves, you have to pay the bill.
Yeah. So I mean, that's one intimidating part, is that you really have to be ready with that stuff.
I mean, for your own sake.
And is that a requirement of a contract to enable me to hire an actor?
It used to be, and then it stopped. They stopped asking for it. And now they're coming back around to asking for it to show that you have it. So it's not technically part of the process, but they are going to ask to see that you have done that, because that's considered due diligence. That's just a process that you should have gone through, is right, to make sure you are fully insured.
So one of the other things that I think comes up is, you know, how do you, those contracts themselves, I am not someone who's going to understand a contract. I have a camera and I want to shoot something. I got a great idea and I got some friends. And like you said, that big house that's nice to shoot in. How am I going to understand those contracts? What are the differences? What's important in there?
It's all important. The first thing you're going to do is, hopefully, you're going to come to the SAGindie website, which is just sagindie.org. And we have the contracts on our website so that you can look at them. You can't use them because SAG-AFTRA has to actually physically give them to you. It has to go through them. And because we don't work for them, we're not a conduit for that. But we will let you see them, read through them. And on our website, we have a whole thing that's signatory process steps. It kind of takes you, like, how many weeks before, and what you should look for, where you should go. But you can look at the contracts and see like kind of the general. And then frankly, if you're just going to call us and say, okay, I'm making this, I kind of don't understand what this part of the contract means, and we'll just explain it to you. We'll ask some questions about what you're making, how much you're spending, how many professional actors do you have compared to non-professionals. Then we'll just kind of explain, okay, here's what you want to do. We try to make it as easy as possible because, yeah, nobody really, lawyers understand lawyer speak, but the rest of us are just trying to figure out why there's so many words to get down to like one idea. So right. We just give you the idea and we forget a lot of those extraneous words.
What about some of the nuances of if I've under one of these contracts and I can't find a SAG actor, I need someone who fits a certain role, fits a certain look, but they aren't union. Now I'm in a situation where I'm stuck. I need a union actor, but I don't have one. I have a union. I have an actor who's not union. What do I do?
Oh, you're never stuck. It's simply a process called you're going to tap Hartley them. That's assuming that you find somebody that you like, somebody who is kind of embodies who you want for that character, and they just happen not to be in SAG-AFTRA, and they're not professional, because we do actually use the term professional and not SAG-AFTRA under these contracts, because not everybody who works a lot is in SAG-AFTRA. If they're on Broadway or if there are other entities that are also professional, and they'll take anybody who has done enough work to be counted as professional. And you'll still sign them under the SAG-AFTRA contract. So if you're looking for somebody for this particular character and you don't find anybody out of the people that you've auditioned, and the one person who is just this amazing natural talent who's not a professional, you're going to Taft-Hartley them. It's a process that costs a little bit of money. It's a few hundred dollars, I think about $500, that allows SAG-AFTRA to cover them and to consider them eligible to join SAG-AFTRA. Now, the upside is you can have whomever you want, and they'll even waive that fee if you have like a really compelling reason. You need somebody who speaks a particular dialect, has a particular set of skills that's not Liam Neeson. If you have a reason, they will sometimes just waive that for you. But if you're like, I really just like this guy and he's 5'9 and brunette, SAG-AFTRA has a ton of 5'9 brunette men. So they're going to say, tap heart, Liam. Mm-hmm. However, and here's something that I just feel so strongly about for actors. If somebody is not currently in the union and they're pretty new to the process, so they don't have a 40 things on their resume, or they don't even have 20 on their resume, but they do get a job and they get tapped Hartley'd into SAG-AFTRA, it makes them eligible, but they should absolutely not join.
Why is that?
You don't want to join SAG-AFTRA when you're brand new, because what you're basically doing is you're jumping into a pool where there are a lot more people who are a lot more experienced than you. So if you are that 5'9 brunette guy and you join the union when you have two things on your resume, you're going to go into a pool of 10,000 5'9 brunette guys who have more on their resume. So who's going to get that job? 9 times out of 10, the more experienced people will get the job. So what you do is when you become eligible, that's fantastic. It means, you know, you've gotten a really good job. Now you keep working until you become a must join, which means you've done 2 or 3 good sized films that are signatory. And at some point, SAG-AFTRA says, okay, you just need to join now. Like, you've done enough kind of under the radar, you need to join. And when you become a must join, that's the time to actually do it. It means you've done enough to really hold up your resume. And it may only take 2 or 3, but it means that the roles were decent. It just means you've done more.
Right. And that 2 or 3, it could take a year or two or a lot more. But in that time, I'm presumably gaining other experience and more classes and everything else, right?
Exactly. In that amount of time, you could actually be putting more on your resume for things that happen to not be union. And the
right.
moment
once they're on my resume, yeah.
And once they're on your resume, you're fine. Like, you can, it'll put things on your reel. You can do all kinds of things. But the moment you pay your dues, you can never go back and do anything that's non-union. And that means your resume has to stand alone until you get jobs and as a SAG-AFTRA actor. And that can be rough if you don't have enough to really show people.
Well, that brings up another,
You just want your reel to reflect what you can do. And you're not going to really get that if it's only one or two roles.
So that brings up an interesting point. If someone is already in the union, of course, they're an actor, but they're probably also producing their own content at this point in the world. That's what many people do, certainly in Hollywood. Does that mean I can't go shoot my own reel piece, just a scene, me and a friend, the two of us just running our own camera? Can we not do that anymore because now I'm SAG?
If you as a SAG actor wanted to go out and just shoot a scene or shoot
a tiny short that I'm just going to show as my reel.
Fact of the matter is you still have to do some paperwork. I mean, the short film agreement, which is now the short project agreement, is such easy kind of paperwork that you it shouldn't be a deterrent. You don't really have to pay yourself. I get a lot of people who are like, I'm just doing this for the production. I don't want to get paid. And on a bigger film, something that's an ultra low, which means you're making a feature film that's $250,000 down to zero, you have to pay people $125 a day plus pension and health. And at the end of the week, SAG-AFTRA is going to expect you to generate a check. Here's something that people don't think about. You have to pay yourself. You have to generate a check because you need to know how to do it correctly. And by the way, putting into your own pension and health is the nicest thing you can do for yourself. But after you get your paycheck, if you really just didn't want to be paid, don't cash the check. Nobody can make you cash a check or cash it and give it back. That's on you. Like all the SAG-AFTRA cares about is that you follow the process correctly. Once you get that check in your hand, you can be like Karen on Will and Grace and just keep them in a box on your desk. And like nobody can tell you at that point what to do with it. You will get taxed on it, though. So keep that in mind.
How do I take care of this later on? I mean, we've shot something. I've been on all the right contracts. I've done everything right. Now we do have that project that had no budget. But now I do start needing to pay. And my actors are going to make some money off the back end because things went really well. It got noticed. What do I do there?
So you're talking distribution after it's all said and done.
Yeah.
First of all, congratulations. That's amazing. You know, distribution is for everyone kind of a difficult area to be in. And a lot of this has to do with what kind of project you've done. So did you do a short project that can go on either theatrical or new media? And are you going on a platform as opposed to theatrical, or did you make a feature and that is getting distribution theatrically?
Let's go with that short feature example, that low budget feature where we were scrappy and not a lot of money, but now there's money that needs to go out after distribution.
Okay, so in that respect, you're either going to be an ultra low, which is the 250 and under, or a modified low, which would be that 250 to 700, or you would be an actual just low budget, because these names are amazing, aren't they? That goes from 700,000 to 2.5 million. And in that respect, at the end of the day, you're going to go to festivals or into market, and there's not a lot that happens as far as distribution. If you've made a deal with your actors for back end, that is between you and them. That was a negotiation. It wasn't something that you had to do. And so once it goes into distribution, it is going to hopefully eventually generate residuals. So here's the important thing to remember. In the packet that you get from SAG-AFTRA, there is a piece of paper, a really simple piece of paper called the Distributor's Assumption Agreement. And that lovely thing is what will keep you either still in the business or will make you so sad you may quit forever. Because what happens is if you sell your film, the rights to your film to signatory company A, that company's job is to then try to sell your film in as many places as it can, right? It's trying to go to different countries. It may be theatrical. It may be on the cable, however they can do it. But every time they do that and it shows, it generates residuals. And those residuals can be $5,000, $10,000, if it's really an amazing run, $20,000. Dollar bill. And if you haven't had that distributor sign this paper that says they will assume the residuals on this, i.e. they will pay the residuals out of what they're making, then you're basically saying, hi, they paid me $12 extra over my film. And now I'm going to get a check for $20,000 in residuals that are owed that I've agreed to pay. And that bill can come due every quarter. It might be $5,000 a quarter. It might be 20. It just depends on what this company that you're not involved in is doing with your film. So you're on the hook for that. You have to make sure that you know what's happening when your film goes to distribution. Ideally, the distribution company would sign the distributor's assumption agreement, and every time they make $500,000 to $1 million selling it to the Ukraine cable network, they will take $10,000 of that and pay the residuals. Because the last thing a filmmaker wants is to get a, you know, open up their mail and be like, oh, look, bill for $15,000. That's fun. Sure,
right.
I have that.
I mean, even if I was getting the money in order to pay it back out, now I'd have to write an awful lot of checks every 3 months.
You would, and you'd be responsible for it. No, and you're ultimately, it means that somebody else is responsible for generating the money that you're going to eventually have to pay.
Yeah.
So I hate that process of like not knowing what they're doing, but only finding out when I get the bill and going, oh, well, it went to the Ukraine. Now I owe $10,000 and now I have to do the process to get money to pay that.
Yeah, I think the sort of the stereotype in LA or the working professionals will get residuals. One day you go to the mailbox and there's money in it, and there's almost never any warning when there is and when there is not.
That's exactly right. And for filmmakers, it's without warning, you get an envelope and instead of a check, it's a bill. And so not as much fun.
So much worse.
So much worse.
What else should people know about trying to make those indie productions and trying to get them in the rules? What are the big mistakes people make?
The biggest mistake people make is to not sign the contracts. We get a lot of people who are like, me and my buddies got together. We did a little thing. Turned out really good. And now we want to send it to festivals, or now somebody is interested in it. What do I do? Can I retroactively sign an agreement? Which you absolutely cannot do. Because the agreement says you're going to work them a certain amount of hours a day. And if you go over that, there are issues. After the fact, there's no way to say, don't work them 18 hours. So you can't do it retroactively. And I've had people say, look, this person really wants to, they're going to buy my film. And I'm like, well, the first thing they're going to ask you are, where are all the contracts? And they're like, oh, yeah. And I'm like, and when you can't actually show them, what distributor wants to then fight your battle to figure out how to get this? They're just going to walk away. They're not going to be like, oh, yeah, we'll put a team of lawyers on your $400,000 film. No, you should have had the contracts. That's the first and foremost. It's just don't. It's not worth it. If you get something great, you'll hate yourself for not having signed the contract. After that, it's actually just not asking questions, either of SAGindie or of SAG-AFTRA, because people are kind of are like, I'm afraid of the answer, and so I'm not going to ask the question. And that is more likely to cost you money than just asking the question and seeing if there's a workaround. SAGindie, because we don't work for SAG-AFTRA, we are an actual kind of no-narc entity. So you can call us and tell us anything, and we will try to get you to where you need to be safely and legally. And we'll tell you, like, okay, here's your risk. If you're not going to do that, here's what can happen to you.
So if I have made some of these mistakes already, I can at least call you and see my options, or hopefully find some options.
Yeah, and we'll do what we can to help you out. Sometimes, you know, our answer might be keep your head down and fingers crossed. Because if it's already out there in the world, you kind of go, well, you know, good luck. Maybe nobody will notice. But
right.
SAG-AFTRA is awfully good at notice.
Sure. I mean, like you said, that is the point, to be noticed. That's why we do so much of this. It's certainly not for the paycheck on an ultra low budget.
Exactly. I think that's also something people don't realize is if you're doing an ultra low film and a professional actor has either auditioned or signed on, they're not surprised that they're not getting paid much. They knew that when they agreed to audition. So it's not about the money. It's about something that you had that was interesting to them. Understand that everybody knows what boat you're in, and everybody's going to work together. And just make sure that your set feels like that, that you know that everybody is sacrificing, everybody is putting in work. So respect everybody and thank everybody. And make it as comfortable as you can, and everybody will pull together.
What's the most important thing that people ought to be doing? I mean, I think the questions is a great example. Is there another example of what people out there should be doing in order to get right with the way this is going to work? How do they learn? How do they How do they make this work in the long run?
Nothing is better than just doing it. So if you're even remotely a writer, then write. Write something that you can make really easily and then make it. It really is. There are no real barriers to this anymore, not on that scale. So you might as well just bite the bullet and make it. You can only learn by getting your hands a little dirty in it.
Well, Darrien Michelle Gipson, thank you so much for doing this with us. Thank you for appearing on Right On.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
And thank you out there for listening. We are absolutely thrilled to have you on. Oh, Darrien, you know, I should ask. We want to just plug the website?
Sure. So,
is there anything else we can plug?
SAGindie is just SAGindie.org. And honestly, if you email us, it will get to one of four of us. If you call us, it's one of four of us who will answer the phone. And we will sit and talk with you until you're either really comfortable with what you're doing, or we'll keep answering your call when you call us every 10 minutes with further questions. And we don't mind. That's what we're here for. Also, look for us if you're ever at film festivals, because we sponsor festivals all around the country. So we may be on a panel or throwing a party or doing any kinds of things. So keep your eyes open for us, because we show up in a lot of places and we're fun. We're nice people.
Well, you've certainly been lovely on the podcast. Darrien Michelle Gipson, thank you so much for doing this with us.
It is my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And if you're out there listening to us, thank you for all those ratings and reviews on iTunes. It means a lot. Please let us know what else you'd like to hear on the podcast. You can tweet at us at Final Draft Inc. or find us anywhere else on social media. Until next time, right on.